Now we're going to look at both diversity within a large culture, but also we're going to look at this question I've been trying to raise during the semester about the environment. The other point that I want to make in the introduction to this article, the one by Marvin Harris, is that much of what anthropologists do, in fact, is analyze things subjectively. We all do that. And I just want to note that Marvin Harris is what we would call an environmental determinist, in that he thinks that cultures are purely a reflection of their environment. I want you to think about this as you read the article and then watch the rest of this video, and think about whether the sacred cow in India, which is a prohibition against eating meat, cattle meat, beef, is it practical or is it stupid? So we're going to look at how the environmental influences or determines culture. So stop, pause this now, and read the article. What did I just say? I said pause it now and read the article. I'm really not kidding about this. I think I make it easy for you to coast with my super useful slideshows, but you got to read the article first. So just read. It's fun. And after you read the article, and it's just a few pages, come back and watch the rest of this. Okay, thank you. I'm glad we understand each other now. Welcome back. Now let's take a look at what the sacred cow looks like in India. So you see the cows walking anywhere and either being ignored, but you didn't see anybody shooing the cows away. And you saw them not being afraid to be out in the open. Can you imagine a cow walking down the street in Jersey City? But that occurs for very specific reasons. And it's basically they are protected by the government. But let's take a look, further look. The term sacred cow, I hope some of you have heard of it, but the age gap, not India, just the term, that's a sacred cow. But the age gap between myself and the students gets greater and greater, so possibly not. But a sacred cow means not In India, it means you cannot kill the cow. But there's other things that are sacred cows in the United States, for example. You could say something's not kosher or taboo against all the rules of society. That's so wrong. Cutting prisons. We're number one in the world in per capita and people in prison. Cutting prison budgets would be a sacred cow. I sometimes get that. Surrey, you've gone too far again. Until recently, we had sacred cows, and we were referred to as that in budgets. For example, no one would have dared until a couple of years ago talk about cutting Social Security, Medicare, the military, spelled wrong, or schools, or separate immigrant children from their parents. Who does that? That would have been a sacred cow. And we still have a few. That's an old one, because these things used to be sacred, but now they're all up. Universities have been cut, parks, police, all these are getting cut now. Until recently, they were sacred cows. What we have left is the billionaire tax. For whatever reason, our governments can't get it together to cut taxes on billionaires. We don't really talk about Trump's affairs. That seems to be a sacred cow. And certainly late assignments would be a sacred cow. Now, you have, as you saw, these cows, potential meals, walking down the street, juxtaposed to starvation in India. Okay? That cow could feed those people. And I'm not making light of this. It should be a no-brainer. But I want us to take a deeper look, and I think you get this now, because I'm sure you read the article about why, in fact, it is something that does make sense to some. Even so, children in India, 3,000 die per day, 66 deaths per 1,000, according to the United Nations. 8% have stunted growth, 20% are wasted, and 70% anemic, and that has serious health repercussions. Now, the question is, can the environmental characteristics be social, environmental shaping of cultures? Again, the sacred cow. Why is it not eaten? Is that a shaping by the environment? We've seen the Kung are nomadic, meaning they travel. Their environment does not allow them to stay in one place. In Tibet, we see polyandry as a reflection of the environment. But this is really, really important. You also saw other forms of marriage in Tibet because the environment influences, but it does not determine. Human beings react different ways in the same situations, excuse me. Now, I want to get to the whys in India. This is a monsoon. 6 months a year. This is the same piece of land in the dry season, also 6 months a year. So this becomes an environmental influence. And we're going to.
Flooding from monsoon rain in western India has swept away much that was in its path, leaving a rising death toll, streets swamped, and vehicles submerged. Gujarat state is among the area's worst hit, the deluge stranding many and turning religious temples into new water soaked attractions.
Now, that was an extreme, but every year they get. In parts of India, these monsoons, which really flood the land. And it's not just like a rainstorm. It is 6 months of wetness. Now, again, the term taboo means not only against the laws of society, but even stricter. so strict. For example, we have very serious laws against murder, but it would be taboo to murder your mother, your father. We have very serious laws about adultery, but that would not be considered a taboo. That just happens. Now, there's a difference between ideal culture, meaning what they say they do, and we have these too. I know if I looked you in the eye, you would tell me, ideally, you do all the readings on time. But we also have real culture or actual culture. And in fact, that's what really happens. So every culture has a set of norms, and then every culture has actual ways they live. So for an example, in India, the cow is protected, yet they have McDonald's in India. And now there's a big controversy because there's protest about McDonald's selling meat in the McDonald's in India. So ideal culture and actual culture are terms I expect to see you use later. Sacred cow did not just happen. 2,000 years ago, it wasn't sacred. You could have your McDonald's 2,000 years ago in India. It was sacrifices permitted in religious ceremonies, for example, and then eaten at religious festivals. Then in the sacred Hindu texts between 600 and 200 BCE, that's anthropological term for BC. It means before Common Era. It began to appear as more and more sacred in the religious text. And by 200, it was totally taboo, the worst possible thing you could do against society to eat the cow. But other religions have certain taboos also. Catholics for a long time couldn't eat meat on Friday. Jews, ideally, and I'm Jewish, aren't supposed to eat shell food, aren't supposed to have milk with beef. That's not kosher. Muslims have a law very similar to kosher. But again, there are strict food taboos in many, many cultures. Now, one explanation might be you don't eat the cow because you need it for milk. But that's not really true because they don't provide a make or break amount of milk. And most cows are not dairy breed. You saw those walking down the street and they were not dairy cows. Believe me, I know the difference. I worked on farms. So the milk they get from not killing the cows is limited and it's a byproduct, a latent result. Cows are most valuable as breeders. So you won't see things like this in India. But they do have uses. And this is Harris's point, that the environment with the flooding has set up a situation where cows are more useful alive than dead. You think of that scene or look at this photograph of how wet it is in India most half the year. It's farming. You cannot use a plow or a tractor during this period, but you can use oxen to do the plow the threshers, act as a mode of transportation. And 70 million farms project a need for 140 million cows. That's because they work in pairs. Yet they only have about 83 million in the country. So they're protecting them as much as they can. And the loss of any cow would be devastating during the rainy season. And the loss of a breeding cow would equally be as devastating. Now, during the dry season, they let the cows wander the streets. They're almost left to starve, so the government has to step in. And they're also barren during the dry season. And that's where you see them wandering the streets. And even though there have been laws to protect the cows for over 2,000 years, they are mistreated versus the idea. The video you saw earlier doesn't show that, but you can see videos of cows being shoved around. Gandhi said we had to protect them. Now, here is the key to the Harris article. There's lots of other uses for the cow, which make it more valuable alive than dead. That's cow poop, fertilizer, dung. Okay, we even have uses for this in the United States. But India has 800 million tons of manure from cows per year. It's valuable. So one use of the manure in the United States is barnyard frisbee. I mentioned to you I worked on farms. This is how we had fun.
Welcome back. The Wisconsin Cow Chip Festival started yesterday, and today the chips were chucked. Some throwers licked their fingers before tossing the cow chips, while others went with more of a traditional frisbee throw. Each contestant chose two cow chips, and the farthest one was the only one that counted. Gloves were not allowed when throwing, and all chips needed to be at least 6 inches in diameter. Welcome back. The Wisconsin...
Yes, boys and girls, I have done that. It is fun. I do wash my hands within a week after I've done it. That's really not part of India, but it is something you can do with dung if you're bored. But they have uses too. Cow manure burns very, very slowly. So they estimate, Harris estimates, that by using cow manure for cooking fuel, they save 43 million tons of coal, and it's cleaner. So it can be used for cooking fuel. Yes, I've done that too. I've done that when I've gone camping. Fertilizer. Those of you that have gardens will buy fertilizer from stores. Me, there is a farm near where I live in New Jersey, and they will allow you, if you take it away and my neighbor has a truck, I do it and rototill it into my garden. And again, the fertilizer is the equivalent of 140 million tons of coal. It smells a little bit. The neighbors get upset with me because I rototill my garden and on alternate years, I'm rototilling either cow manure or chicken manure. And it stinks for about a week. I could care less. Another use is home repair. That cows could be used, cow manure, to patch the roof, to fill the cracks in the wall. Because when it dries, it stays dry. It doesn't get all mushy. Dead cows also have a use. Remember ideal versus actual. The untouchable, which are the lowest class in India, in fact, not only sell them, but they are allowed to eat them. So a group that is starving more than any other group has an outlet. So they'll haul them away. They could sell the skin for leather. Pause. Look at yourselves. I bet all of you are wearing or have worn some piece of leather today. Where do you think it comes from? And it's not taboo for them to eat it. It's against the law, but it's not strongly enforced. And Muslims and Christians in India, they can eat it. They even have legal cow slaughterhouses. So ideal and actual. Now, Harrison, his cultural materialism says, despite devaluation, more valuable, that should be alive rather than dead. Sorry about that. And that's the ideal versus the actual culture. Okay. You can get a lot of meat out of that. Now, this is another important piece of it, which Harris doesn't emphasize as much as other types of anthropologists, including myself, would, which is the religious power. The religion of the Hindus is who held, until the British came, the maximum power. So by controlling what people eat, they were able to control the people, making something taboo, besides the arguments that Harris gives, gives the religious leaders more power. And again, I want you to think about cultural relativism. We see the starving people, we see the hamburgers walking down the street. As I said earlier, to us, it's a no-brainer. But to them, they get so much out of it. They get their plows, they get their fertilizer, they get their cooking fuel, they get leather. But ideal versus actual, there are slaughterhouses in India. They do let some cows starve to death. Sometimes they even trick the mother into kicking the cow to death. I think I've only mentioned twice in this presentation that I worked on farms. So here's the third one. If you want to have fun with somebody, have them milk the cow on the right side and the cow will kick that person. And sometimes they trick the mother into kicking the calf to death by placing the calf on the right side rather than the left side. And again, they don't have to feed the cow, it's dead. So some of the prosperous farmers will do that. They'll sell them to Muslims. They wear them as clothing. For example, 2010, Madonna had a use for a cow when she wore an all meat dress to the Emmy. So I'm gonna fade out on that, but I want you to think again that you read the article, how the environment can influence a culture, but also think in this culture, as in Tibet, not everybody responds the same way. So I would say it's more of an influence, it's an option, but not a determination. So I'm gonna let Madonna do her thing and then go do your homework.
Lady Gaga attended the MTV Video Music Awards ceremony on September 12, 2010 in an unusual outfit, a dress made entirely of raw meat. Lady Gaga was a big winner at the VMAs, taking home Moon Men statues for Video of the Year, Best Female Video, and Best Pop Video for Bad Romance. She accepted the Video of the Year award wearing the meat dress, which also featured a matching meat hat, lace-up shoes, and a meat purse, which she asked Cher to hold as she made her acceptance speech. When asked about her unusual fashion statement, Lady Gaga, who is a vegan, said the dress had many interpretations, but for me this evening, if we don't stand up for what we believe in, and if we don't fight for our rights, pretty soon we're going to have as much rights as the meat on our own bones, and I am not a piece of meat. Gaga said the dress was not meant to disrespect anyone that is vegan or vegetarian. According to MTV, the raw meat outfit was made by fashion designer Frank Fernandes, and while some expected an outlandish outfit or two from Lady Gaga, not everyone was pleased with her fleshy attire. TMZ quoted a representative from PETA as saying, after time spent under the TV lights, it would smell like the rotting flesh that it is and likely be crawling in maggots. The PETA rep told TMZ that Lady Gaga's wearing a dress made from cuts of dead cows is offensive enough to bring comment. This isn't Lady Gaga's first raw meat fashion statement. She also appeared on the cover of Japan's September 2010 Vogue magazine wearing a bikini made of raw meat.